The next item of business is a statement by John Swinney on COVID-19 update. The Deputy First Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on John Swinney, Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'll be providing the update to Parliament today on the latest COVID-19 situation on behalf of the First Minister. And given the update, I'll provide an assessment of the current course of the pandemic and our ongoing consideration of how to respond, an update on the pressures on the National Health Service looking ahead to the winter, a report on the progress we are making to deliver the vaccination programme, an update on changes to international travel rules, and an update on management of the risks of transmission at or around COP26. First, though, I will report on the most recent statistics. 2,233 positive cases were reported yesterday. 12% of all tests conducted were positive. 753 people are currently in hospital with COVID, 23 fewer than yesterday. 57 people are receiving intensive care, 4 more than yesterday. And sadly, a further 20 deaths have been reported over the past 24 hours. That takes the total number of deaths registered under this definition to 9,313. And I would like to send my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one during the pandemic. More positively, the vaccination programme continues to make good progress. I can confirm that 4,324,440 people have received a first dose, 3,918,528 have had both doses, and 1,017,359 have received a booster vaccination or third primary vaccination. The vaccination programme is continuing at considerable pace. I'm pleased to say that the United Kingdom Government's COVID data dashboard confirms that our booster programme continues to be the best performing rollout in the United Kingdom. Today is also a major milestone in that programme, as we have reached 1 million COVID boosters and third doses, totaling 2 million doses of both COVID and flu vaccines. This is an amazing achievement, and I want to thank everyone involved for their extraordinary efforts. This further demonstrates that the booster programme is performing exceptionally well. In total, 88% of the over 18 population is now fully vaccinated with two doses. This includes 99% of over 50s, 88% of those aged 40 to 49, 77% of 30 to 39-year-olds, and 68% of 18 to 29-year-olds. In addition, 76% of 16 and 17-year-olds and 55% of 12 to 15-year-olds have had a first dose. For most people in these age groups, only a single dose is recommended at this stage. Presiding Officer, after the most recent peak in new cases at around the start of September, the spread of the virus has not reduced to anything like the low levels that we had seen following the lockdowns. At slightly over 2,500, the number of new cases each day is holding at a concerningly high level. The situation is precarious and unpredictable. If the previous pattern, characterised by waves of infection, is repeated, there is a risk that the spread of the virus could very quickly increase again during the coming weeks, perhaps over the Christmas period. Starting from the current high level of infection in the community and the intense pressure the NHS is already under as a result, some scenarios for what may happen next are very concerning. We need to avoid the most dangerous of those scenarios. And there are some specific reasons to suspect that case numbers may increase in the weeks ahead. With the onset of colder winter weather, increased time spent indoors means there will be more opportunities for COVID to circulate. COP26 has seen people from all over the world meeting in Glasgow, and that presents a known infection risk. And many of us will wish to spend time visiting loved ones over the festive period. But we are not yet able to predict with confidence what will happen next. We certainly want to avoid the sort of strict lockdowns we have seen before most of us were vaccinated. We do not want to repeat the sort of disruption to our daily lives, businesses and the economy that had been required at earlier stages in the pandemic. But we do need to take appropriate measures to keep the pandemic under control. It is because we want to avoid more difficult restrictions that we cannot rule out strengthening the baseline protective measures currently in place as the best way to head off any prospect of future lockdowns. Indeed, all governments in the United Kingdom have said much the same, not least, for example, the United Kingdom government's Plan B. We have been considering, for example, whether we may need to extend the COVID certification scheme to bring more settings into scope, such as indoor hospitality and leisure settings. Among other possible interventions, we are exploring how we can help improve ventilation, what we could do to increase home working, and whether changes are needed to extend the use of face coverings. I would stress, though, that we have not yet taken any decisions about strengthening the existing baseline measures, and we will be discussing options with business sectors in the course of this week. As you would expect, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government has been exploring all options for how it will respond to the evolving situation. We have been reviewing our strategic framework, which defines the Scottish Government's overall approach to responding to the pandemic. And the next three-weekly review of the existing baseline measures will take place a week today. The First Minister, my Cabinet colleagues and I are, of course, watching the situation closely and stand ready to respond at the right time when the data indicates it is necessary and proportionate. The challenges we currently face and the continuing spread of the virus mean that now is certainly not the time to relax our approach. We all need to redouble our efforts to adhere to the protective measures in place and to follow the guidance. For that reason, I want to take this opportunity to reiterate the appeal that the First Minister, my Cabinet colleagues and others have been making to members of the public, to businesses, to transport providers and to organisations throughout Scotland. Please do get vaccinated, including booster jabs and flu vaccinations for those that are eligible. Please wear face coverings when required. Ventilate indoor spaces where possible, wash hands and surfaces regularly, use lateral flow device tests regularly, and book a PCR test if one of the lateral flow tests shows up as positive, or if you have symptoms of COVID, or if you are identified as a close contact of someone who is positive. Please continue to give contact details when visiting pubs and restaurants, and COVID certificates should be shown if visiting a venue where this is required. And critically, please do continue to work from home wherever possible. The government knows that none of this is easy, but it is vital that these efforts continue. Presiding Officer, the entire health and care system remains under considerable pressure. For many months, our health and social care services have been dealing with levels of demand usually only experienced in winter. Across the country, hospitals are at or close to capacity. The social care system is also under pressure and reporting an increase in the number of people requiring care packages. Indeed, the continued high number of cases of COVID-19 means that the pressure on our National Health Service is greater than at any time in its 73-year history. As of today, COVID-related hospital occupancy, the number of patients in hospital with COVID at any given time, is 753 compared to 932 a week ago. Hospital admissions also remain high, although have decreased slightly. There were 585 people with COVID being admitted to hospital in the latest week, compared to 687 in the first week in October. Admissions to ICU have also decreased slightly over the past month. NHS staff are dealing with significant numbers of COVID patients alongside other patient care. They are also preparing for and responding to wider winter pressures and dealing with the backlog of care built up in earlier stages of the pandemic. As I've set out, there is a real risk that the pressure on the National Health Service could intensify further during the weeks and months ahead, including as we enter the winter flu season. The Scottish Government is working closely with health boards as they deal with these pressures. The Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care set out last week the measures we are taking to support the NHS in preparing for and responding to the pressures now and the challenges that lie ahead. As we know, vaccination has proven to be one of our most effective public health interventions against this pandemic. The first phase of the programme delivered more than 8 million COVID vaccinations in 10 months. With COVID boosters, flu vaccines and jabs for new groups, we now need to deliver roughly the same number of vaccines again, 7.5 million, by early next year. The vaccination programme is continuing at considerable pace. We have now administered in total more than 1 million boosters and third doses. We are nonetheless continuing to explore how we might increase capacity further for example, by establishing additional clinics, particularly at evenings and weekends. We are confident that the programme remains on track. We are now sending letters to those aged 60 to 69 and those with underlying health conditions, inviting them to appointments at local community clinics, which will run throughout November. We will then, from mid-November, launch the online self-booking portal for adults aged 50 and over, those aged over 16 who are unpaid carers, and household contacts of immunosuppressed individuals, with the aim of offering vaccines to everyone over 50 by early next year. This has been a huge job for the National Health Service. I would like once again to offer my thanks to the National Health Service staff working tirelessly to keep us safe. Can I also take this opportunity to reiterate our thanks to the armed forces for agreeing to support our vaccination effort by complementing our existing workforce. We've asked the people of Scotland to help us deliver the vaccination programme by coming to appointments where possible and rescheduling where necessary. By being vaccinated and having a booster vaccination, we can protect each other and help the National Health Service through what will be another exceptionally busy winter period. Turning now, Presiding Officer, to the question of international travel. Colleagues will be aware that the United Kingdom Government yesterday announced a change to international travel rules for England, recognising a wider range of vaccines. The Scottish Government will also make this change to regulations for arrivals here. With effect from Monday, the 22nd of November, we will recognise vaccines on the World Health Organisation emergency use list, as well as those approved in the United Kingdom by the MHRA. These individual vaccines are Sinopharm and Sinovac, manufactured in China, and Covaxin, manufactured in India. Travellers who have been vaccinated with these products will be eligible for quarantine-free travel if they have a certificate of vaccination status from a country listed in our regulations that meets the data and security standards required at the United Kingdom border. There are now over 130 countries where we recognise vaccine certificates, although China is not yet on that list. There is a process of engagement led by the Foreign Office to work with international partners so that we bring more countries in scope as soon as possible, where we are satisfied it is safe and secure to do so. Further announcements on this matter will be made on a four nations basis. In addition, we will also simplify rules for children under 18 years of age. All children will now follow the rules for eligible vaccinated travellers, whether or not they are yet fully vaccinated. That means a test on day two after arrival, but no isolation and no test before departure or on day eight. Presiding Officer, the final update I want to give today relates to the COP26 summit in Glasgow. The summit is one of the most important gatherings of the century so far. The Scottish Government has been doing everything we can to help make it a success. The Scottish Government has been working very closely with the United Kingdom Government and partners in Scotland, including Glasgow City Council, Transport Scotland, NHS Scotland and Police Scotland, to ensure the summit is delivered safely. COVID-19 has presented significant challenges to staging this unique event. The scale and worldwide draw of COP26 poses risk of spread of COVID-19 both within delegates and to or from the local population of Scotland and the United Kingdom. A comprehensive and exceptional package of mitigation measures has been in place to ensure the event is delivered safely, helping to protect the welfare of everyone involved and the wider community. In addition to vaccination, measures include a robust testing regime, contact tracing, hygiene measures and ventilation. Of course, while public health measures can mitigate the spread of COVID-19 to an extent, there remains a risk that COP26 could increase the spread of the virus. That is why COVID-19 continues to be closely monitored by all relevant agencies and why the Scottish Government is closely involved in operational decisions during the event. As of the 5th of November, the cumulative test positivity results for Blue Zone pass holders based on lateral flow tests was around 0.1%. However, we are only just past the midpoint of the conference and we continue to monitor the situation carefully. We will provide a further update following the conclusion of COP unless there is a need to do so at an earlier opportunity. Presiding Officer, the successful rollout of the vaccination programme has been enabling us to live with far fewer restrictions and mitigations in place than were necessary a few short months ago. But case numbers remain high, and looking ahead to the winter months, there is a real risk they may increase again. Hundreds of people each week are still being admitted to hospital with COVID, and our National Health Service is under intense pressure. COVID remains a threat. We all need to play our part in keeping the virus under control. For that reason, I make no apologies for repeating again the three things we can all do to help protect each other. Firstly, please do get vaccinated if eligible and haven't yet done so. That includes going for a booster jab. It is never too late to get vaccinated, and it remains the single most important thing any of us can do to protect ourselves and the people around us. Secondly, please take regular LFD tests. These can be ordered through the NHS Inform website or collected from a local test site or pharmacy. If an individual tests positive or are identified as a close contact or have symptoms of the virus, they should self-isolate and book a PCR test. And thirdly, please comply with the mitigations still in place. Work from home when possible, wear face coverings in indoor public places such as shops, public transport, and when moving about in hospitality settings, wash hands and surfaces thoroughly, meet outdoors if you can. I know that this will be increasingly difficult as we get deeper into winter, but outdoor environments are safer. And when meeting indoors, please open windows. Anything to improve ventilation will help. And try where possible to keep a safe distance from people in other households. These precautions make a crucial difference. They will protect individuals and the people around us all and help to ease the burden on the National Health Service. I express once again the thanks of the Scottish Government to everyone in Scotland for what they are doing to help protect each other, and I encourage people to continue to take the steps necessary to ensure we all remain safe.
Thank you. The Deputy First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now, and I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And it's very welcome that we've reached a new milestone in terms of the COVID booster jab. And I would encourage everyone who is able to do so to take that up as soon as possible. The vaccine has been immensely successful, and it should be our main weapon against the virus. Considering reintroducing restrictions at this stage in the pandemic, when we have a vaccine that 4.3 million Scots have received, is the wrong approach. Today, John Swinney says the government is considering the need to extend the COVID vaccine passport scheme to more premises. The same John Swinney who just last week said there was no evidence that COVID passports had reduced the spread of the virus. If he doesn't know if it's working, why is he looking to expand it? How can this government take these plans forward when they know the damage the scheme is already doing to Scottish businesses and the impact that it's having on people's jobs? He says he's considering to expand the scope of the scheme to include further indoor hospitality and leisure settings. Exactly which venues will be impacted by this change? Because the statement, as it currently is, only brings more uncertainty. Uncertainty for businesses at an extremely difficult time. They need to know if they are on the cusp of being hit with added costs and extra hassle. And finally, the Deputy First Minister says the government is considering extending the use of face masks. Does that mean keeping them in classrooms throughout winter, knowing the disruption they cause in our schools, when the government's own advisory subgroup in education said over a month ago that the time was right to end their use? Thank you.
Deputy First Minister.
Can I thank Mr. Ross for his welcome of the progress on the booster vaccination programme, because I think it is important that today we acknowledge the very significant landmark that has been achieved by the staff, both in the National Health Service and the Armed Forces, who've been delivering, and the volunteers who've delivered such an exceptional and at pace programme, given the volume of vaccination between the flu and the booster programme, that it's an enormous physical undertaking. So I very much appreciate Mr Ross's comments in that respect. In relation to the vaccine certification programme, the government throughout the whole handling of the pandemic has been open with the public, open about what we feel necessary to consider. And what I would say to Mr Ross, and I recounted this to the COVID Recovery Committee last Thursday, we are at a pivotal moment in the pandemic. We are about to approach winter. We have cases that are sitting at what I think would have to be described at an uncomfortably and consistently high level of, on average, around about 2,500 cases per day. That is much, much higher than when we came out of the lockdown restrictions before. And we are still seeing admissions to hospital in excess of 500 in the last 7 days. So we face significant threats and dangers, so the government has to be open with the public about the fact that we may have to take other decisions. I stress the word may have to take other decisions should the situation be more challenging. Now, Mr Ross will know that the government has to satisfy itself that any measures it takes are proportionate, that they can be justified as proportionate in law, as to the restrictions they may place against individuals or against businesses. The government is satisfied that what we have done so far to date has been the case, and of course any further judgment would have to pass that test as well. And lastly, in relation to the question of vaccine certification, the point that I made last week to the committee was that I cannot establish a direct connection between one individual measure and the levels of the virus. We've never been able to do that, and we'll be very candid about that. But what the government has to be satisfied about is that we have adequate protections in place to safeguard the public alongside the rise in the number of vaccinations that have taken place and the levels of hospitalisation and levels of cases. So that's the framework we consider, and we'll take decisions accordingly. Lastly, on the question of face coverings, the government has judged with the input of the Chief Medical Officer that it was appropriate to maintain face coverings in schools for some pupils and for some staff. Obviously that's a judgment which will be subject to review, and the government will consider these issues when we undertake the three-weekly review and report to Parliament accordingly.
Daniel Johnson.
Thank you. Can I begin by expressing my condolences to all of those who've lost a loved one to the virus, and to pay tribute to all of those, especially in the health service, who are on the front line of battling this pandemic. It will be of significant concern to all of those running hospitality businesses what the Deputy First Minister stated in terms of the prospect of rolling out the vaccine passport to yet more context, especially given the broad and non-specific nature of his statement. So can he take this opportunity to clarify the following things? First of all, what process and timeline will the government be adhering to in terms of examining the rollout of the passports? Will they publish further evidence regarding transmission specifically within these settings? Will they also confirm whether a negative test will be taken in lieu of a vaccine passport? And finally, in terms of the specifics around enforcement, and this is a particular point raised with me by the hospitality industry just last week, who were pointing out that while nightclubs have door staff and they have a natural point to check these things, cafes don't tend to have door staff, and therefore the practicalities of checking passports in these contexts is hugely more challenging. Can I also just ask about the booster programme? And we're share the welcome and the landmark that we have reached with that. But the progress of this continues to be variable. In my own area, people are waiting 2 to 3 hours to receive their boosters. Accessibility in terms of the location of these sites is still problematic. And the promise of combined flu and booster jabs at the same time simply is not a reality. And indeed, we see very variable rollout rates across health board areas. So what steps will the government take to step in and support health boards who are struggling to roll out the booster vaccines for whatever reason there may be? Thank you.
Deputy First Minister.
In response to the points that Mr. Johnson has raised, the government, you know, stressing the remarks that I've made to Parliament today are about the government being open with the public about what we are considering. And Mr Johnson will know that there is a three-weekly review that we will undertake next week, and these issues will be part of the consideration. At this stage, I cannot say to Parliament whether the discussions will be concluded by then, because fundamentally, the judgment as to whether or not the COVID certification scheme needs to extend any further has to be driven by the evidence of the pandemic. What is the prevalence of the level of the virus in the community? What is the level of pressure on the National Health Service? What is the level of vaccination that is underway? And the government has to make a proportionate judgment about those questions. He asked me specifically about the question about whether a negative LFD test would be a possible alternative to that. And I confirm that the government is considering that very question as part of these deliberations. In relation to the question of enforcement by proprietors and operators of any hospitality venues, obviously there is a requirement still for contact tracing data to be retained by many of these venues, and we encourage people to participate in that. So obviously there are opportunities for such exchanges between operators of venues to be able to undertake that discussion to satisfy themselves of that point. Lastly, in relation to the booster programme, I've heard points that, and obviously aware of points that have been raised about the accessibility of certain venues for individuals and the waiting times that have been involved. The Health Secretary has been discussing these issues with individual health boards. Obviously, there is a huge volume of activity being undertaken. As a consequence, there may well at times be congestion at individual facilities if that is the case. But I do give Mr Johnson the assurance that the Health Secretary and officials are in active dialogue on an ongoing basis with health boards to offer support where it is necessary to do so and to enable health boards to be able to deliver the joint vaccination programmes between the flu and the booster jags to make sure that the inconvenience to members of the public is kept to an absolute minimum as they participate in this important programme.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Taken in the context of remarks from the Royal College of Nurses to a parliamentary committee this morning about workforce pressures, the crisis affecting our NHS is really scary, and we've already seen that the waiting times crisis has proved fatal. But the last thing this government should do is rush towards and embrace solutions that are ineffective. Now, the Deputy First Minister has answered questions to Douglas Ross and to Daniel Johnson, citing evidence and that he will follow the evidence. But research published by The Lancet last week has shown that whilst vaccines are excellent at preventing harm, they are ineffective at preventing transmission. Now, Liberal Democrats warned that when vaccine certification came in, it would be see the steady creep into other aspects of our lives. This statement is the start of that creep. Now, the Deputy First Minister has dangled the threat to the festive period as possible justification for their future rollout. Yet clinicians are showing him evidence that there is no evidence base for their use. So will he rule them out today, as they will not save Christmas?
Deputy First Minister.
I don't see how Mr. Cole-Hamilton can possibly expect me to give a positive response to his question with what I've just put on the record in my parliamentary statement. And Mr. Cole-Hamilton's question has a fundamental contradiction at the heart of it. Mr. Cole-Hamilton marshalled the dangers that face the National Health Service over the course of the next few months. I couldn't have said it better myself. It was an accurate reflection of the challenges that are faced. We've then got to make sure we have got sufficient protection in place to ensure that we reduce any impact on the National Health Service. What we know is that people who are double vaccinated have less symptoms than if people are not vaccinated. So as a consequence, that naturally answers Mr. Cole-Hamilton's question that if people are double vaccinated, therefore having a COVID certificate as a consequence, they are likely to be exposed to less danger and we will be able to sustain more aspects of our social and economic activity. Yeah. So it all follows. The only problem is that Mr. Cole Hamilton is missing a fundamental step of logic in his answer, in the question that he puts to me.
Deputy First Minister, can I have a moment, please? We have an ongoing dialogue across the chamber, and I'm trying to understand what is being said, so I'd be grateful if colleagues could be quiet when the Deputy First Minister is responding. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So my simple point to Mr. Cole Hamilton is that there are a number of steps we can take to try to avert the enormous pressure that he foresees in the National Health Service in the winter, which I agree with, and the government is trying to take the necessary and proportionate steps to make sure we can do that.
John Mason, to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you very much. I very much welcome the indication in the statement that COP is not having, so far at least, a negative effect on COVID. And last night I certainly attended an event where we had to show our certificate, we had to wear masks, and it all went perfectly well. Has the Deputy First Minister any further advice to give to those attending COP?
Deputy First Minister.
The one appeal that I would make is that for people to apply and to follow the guidance and the restrictions that we have in place. I don't think they are in any way an obstacle to individuals successfully participating in COP. The type of routine measures that Mr. Mason talked about that he experienced last night are the types of measures that we would like to see in place across the board that minimises the risk of transmission and maximises the chances of protecting the public. And that's exactly what we have focused on in the preparation for COP, which is being maintained, and we are working hard with Glasgow City Council, the UK Government and NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde to ensure that we are managing any implications that arise.
Rachel Hamilton, to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The NHS and social care sector are under unimaginable pressure, and I'd like to thank them for what they do. In 2014, the then Health Secretary, Shona Robison, said that she would urgently prioritise and eradicate bed blocking in hospitals. 6 years on, hospital beds are filled with 1,615 medically fit people with no place to go. Deputy First Minister, put yourself in their shoes or the shoes of their families and tell us, please, what this government will do in terms of the specific measures in place to resolve the indignity of bed blocking for thousands of vulnerable and elderly people across Scotland.
Deputy First Minister.
I acknowledge this is a serious issue, and that is why the government has put in place measures in dialogue with our partners in local government to make sure that individuals can be safely released from hospital settings and into appropriate settings, whether that's in their own home or in some other form of care facility. But one of the points which is at the heart of this issue is about the availability of staff in the social care sector. And this has been the subject of extensive dialogue with our local authority partners and with third sector providers. And one of the issues that we face, I'm afraid, is as a consequence of Brexit and the loss of free movement of citizens. And Rachel Hamilton may feign exasperation, and Mr. Kerr may shout out at me, and Ms. Weber may shake her head, but the reality is that evidence is staring the Conservatives in the face, that we are suffering because we have lost the access to population that was providing a vital support to our social care sector. Now, one of the measures we are doing is we're improving the remuneration for social care workers. That was part of what the Health Secretary announced some weeks ago. We are working with our local authority partners to make sure that we've got the maximum amount of arrangements in place to support the transition of individuals from hospitals to the community. We are supporting local authorities with the resources to enable them to do that. But one of the consistent points of feedback from local authorities is the difficulties in recruiting staff to enable them to deliver these services. And we'll support them in those efforts, but I think we have to have an honest understanding of what the problems happen to be.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Deputy First Minister, on boosters, and I appreciate these are exceptions, but several elderly constituents, some in the catchment of NHS Lothian, some in NHS Borders, were unable to get through to the helpline, and those that did were told the earliest date for their booster would be late December, and I even have one couple in Pennycook who are in their 80s who were told by the helpline January the 1st, 2022. Can that be right when younger age groups are being offered boosters and even booking online?
Deputy First Minister.
I am concerned by that information from Christine Graham, because certainly for people in the over 70s grouping, they should be the vaccination programme should be completed for them well before December. So, well before the end of the year in December. So I think if Christine Graham would like to share specific information with the Health Secretary about these issues, we will explore that. Certainly, the booster programme should be delivered at an earlier stage to that age group. We are beginning, as I said in my statement, to issue letters to those in the 60 to 69 age groups, so the older categories should be satisfactorily resolved by then. But if Christine Graham would like to write to the Health Secretary, that would be appreciated.
Paul O'Kane, to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I associate myself with thanks to all of our vaccination staff as we acknowledge the vaccination milestone. The Deputy First Minister referred in his statement to concerns about winter flu and the pressures of the flu season. And rollout of the flu vaccine must be faster if we're to ensure vulnerable Scots aren't left unprotected this winter. In common with colleagues across the chamber, I have heard issues about people who have respiratory issues not being called for their flu vaccine, people in the same household being unable to travel together when they provide one another transport, and indeed nursery staff in my region were told that they won't be vaccinated for flu in school, along with the teaching staff, as they work in a separate area of the school campus. Indeed, they were told to make their own arrangements. Given the urgency with flu season approaching, can you tell me what percentage of people who are eligible will have received a flu jab by Christmas, and will he provide a firm date by which he expects the most vulnerable to be protected from flu before the onset of midwinter?
Deputy First Minister.
I think I recognise the importance of the points that Mr O'Kane raises, but I think he would also, I am sure, appreciate that in a programme of the scale and complexity, taking account of all of the circumstances and scenarios that he put to me, which I think they are reasonable points, is difficult in a programme of that complexity and magnitude. That's why the online portal system, which we are putting in place for younger age groups, is designed to give people a bit of flexibility to be able to address some of the practical circumstances that he said. Now, if I could, Mr. O'Kane asked me for some data. The flu vaccine programme has so far administered over 1.4 million doses to date. So it is making very good progress. And since the start of the flu vaccination programme, taking flu and the third dose and booster programme together, we have surpassed 2.5 million doses on those programmes in a relatively short space in time. Now, that, I hope, gives Parliament some confidence, because if we've got 7.5 million doses to do by the spring, 2.5 million since about the start of September is a pretty substantial effort to get to where we've got to. So I do assure them that we're trying to be as flexible as possible, but of critical importance is ensuring that we cover the volume of vaccinations that are required, and I think Parliament should be encouraged by the progress that's been made to date.
Willie Coffey, to be followed by Donald Cameron.
Hey, thank you. Can I ask the Deputy First Minister if he's aware that many young adults who were recently turned 18 and are now eligible for their double vaccination are losing out financially because they have purchased expensive tickets for concerts and other events but cannot now use them because of the timing of their vaccinations and the requirement for certification? Is this something that the government might look at, if we can persuade events management organisers to agree refunds for these young people who, as we know, have already borne the brunt of many of the restrictions during the pandemic?
Deputy First Minister.
I think some of the scenario that Mr. Coffey puts to me can be addressed by the fact that we did invite young people who were 17 to come forward for vaccination before their 18th birthdays, and obviously that would have preceded the introduction of the certification scheme. But I'm very happy to explore in further detail some of the issues that Mr. Coffey raises and to identify if there are practical steps we can take to try to address the situation. Nobody wants to see anybody disadvantaged, but we are trying to maximise the protection that's in place for the wider population by ensuring that individuals are double vaccinated. But if Mr. Coffey wishes to write to me with further details about this scenario, I will happily consider that.
Donald Cameron, to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you. As Douglas Ross has already said, last month the Scottish Government was advised by its own expert education advisory group, chaired by Professor Linda Bould, that the rules on face coverings in schools should be relaxed due to their impact on the well-being of young people. Why was that advice rejected? And will ministers now consider removing the blanket requirement for pupils and teachers to wear face coverings, given that this is plainly a disproportionate and damaging measure?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the issue that Mr. Cameron raises with me is one the government has considered very carefully, because the advice that was given to ministers came at a moment where the situation around the pandemic was deteriorating. And we took further medical advice from the Chief Medical Officer, which suggested that the ministers concluded that it was better to operate on a more cautious approach, given the fact that the wider course of the pandemic was deteriorating. And part of the argument I've tried to maintain throughout this whole discussion with Parliament has been that we must take a balanced set of judgments looking at the overall course of the pandemic. And much though we may not like particular components of the steps that we've got to take place, we've got to take a range of measures which avoid us doing other more dramatic interventions to try to stem the circulation of the virus. So what I would explain to Mr. Cameron is that the government is looking at that evidence in the round, making a judgment. If we believe there are opportunities for us to relax those restrictions, we will take those opportunities. But we have to also be mindful of the likely course of the pandemic, given what I've put on the record today about the onset of winter, the possible impact of COP, the fact that people are going to be able to spend less time out of doors than indoors. So there's a complex picture that has to be wrestled with, because nobody wants to find themselves in a situation where our National Health Service is overwhelmed at any stage in the future, because that is the situation we have been consistently trying to avoid. And what I've marshalled in front of Parliament today, what's shared with members on a regular basis, is the volume of pressure the National Health Service is experiencing, and nobody wants to see the National Health Service overwhelmed.
Stephanie Callaghan, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you. My question is around ensuring fair access to events and travel. Deputy First Minister, can you confirm what arrangements are in place for people who cannot currently take COVID vaccines due to a confirmed or suspected allergic reaction to obtain a medical exemption letter from the vaccine certification scheme?
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, obviously the vaccination is demonstrably of benefit to the overwhelming majority of the population based on the evidence that has been gathered. But there will be individual cases where the vaccination does not operate compatibly with some individuals. So local vaccination centres can help answer questions about the vaccine and advise what arrangements can be put in place to enable safe vaccination. In the rare cases that I'm talking about where an individual cannot be vaccinated, then an individual will be identified as either able to safely receive the vaccine but decides not to do so, or as clinically unable to safely receive the vaccine, in which cases they will receive a secure paper exemption certificate by post, which will provide them with the ability to access venues on the clear understanding that there is an appropriate justification for them not to be double vaccinated.
Julian Mackay, to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm concerned about vaccination of people who may have changed priority groups since the vaccination rollout started. For example, if someone was classed as clinically extremely vulnerable or at risk, but is now no longer considered to be so, they will have received their initial doses earlier than others, but may not qualify for a booster due to their change in status. The same can be said of others, such as those who were unpaid carers, but whose circumstances may have changed due to the death of those who they were caring for. Can the Deputy First Minister advise those who may have changed category of when they should get their vaccine booster?
Deputy First Minister.
It's difficult for me to give a specific answer to the general proposition, the general but legitimate proposition that Gillian Mackay puts to me. So I think what the best advice I can give is for individuals, should they find themselves in that circumstance, is to contact the helpline to secure advice or to secure alternative clinical advice, which will enable us to make a judgment about what is the best course of action individual by individual. Because even on the scenarios that Gillian Mackay put to me, it could be those circumstances may have accelerated someone's access to the programme or in fact may have delayed their access. So I think an individual assessment of those circumstances through engagement with the helpline would be the best way forward and potentially the pursuit of other clinical advice.
Claire Adamson to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Deputy First Minister for his statement and his ambition that we return to social and economic activity as quickly and safely as possible. But last week, following the Chancellor's budget statement, OBR official Sir Charlie Bean predicted that real household disposable incomes will not reach pre-pandemic levels until the end of 2023. Does the Deputy First Minister agree that the Chancellor needs to U-turn on his spending of plans, including the cut to universal credit uplift, as these plans will leave millions of people worse off across the UK?
Deputy First Minister.
President Officer, at the heart of the Government's COVID recovery strategy is the determination to ensure that we do all that we can to eradicate child poverty, to address the inequalities that existed pre-pandemic, which have been exacerbated by the pandemic. So the point that Claire Adamson puts to me is an important point about how we deliver recovery from COVID for the population. And I made clear to Parliament in my statement on the 5th of October the fact that the tackling of inequality that has worsened under COVID would be at the centre of the Government's COVID recovery strategy, and certainly the suggestions that Claire Addison has made of the Chancellor maintaining the uplift to universal credit would assist us in our efforts to reduce child poverty and to support families that are experiencing the difficulties that come with living on low incomes.
Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I too, like others, would like to put on record my thanks and congratulations to all of those involved in the vaccine programme, including the booster vaccine, in terms of the milestones we've reached to date. I wrote to the Health Secretary in September, highlighting several concerns around the current crisis in our NHS and ambulance services. This week, I received a reply from the Chief Operating Officer of NHS Scotland, in which he explained that additional assistance, including but not limited to over 100 military personnel, around 100 second-year paramedic students, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and the British Red Cross and private transport companies, has been brought in to support the hard-working health service staff. To any reasonable onlooker, this indeed is a crisis, yet the letter and the government still say that the NHS is not overwhelmed. Presiding Officer, Deputy First Minister, I'm really worried about the NHS. I'm really worried about the staff who are working in it, and I'm really worried about my constituents and people across Scotland who need it to be delivering. I have countless stories of people having their surgery cancelled and unacceptable delays in waiting for ambulances. The current situation is letting those people who rely on the service down and working within it who've gone above and beyond throughout the pandemic. If this isn't a situation where the NHS is overwhelmed and in crisis, what would the Deputy First Minister say it is, and when can people expect to have a functioning health service again?
Deputy First Minister.
I think the detail that Pam Duncan-Glancy puts on the record in a sense reinforces the fundamental argument I've been making with Parliament this afternoon, that the National Health Service is under extraordinary pressure. I don't think it is overwhelmed, but it is under extraordinary pressure. And the balance, the fine balance the government is trying to strike, is about enabling as much of our economy and our society to function without interruption, without restriction at this moment, whilst not allowing so much of that to happen that the National Health Service does in fact become overwhelmed. Because that will, Pam Duncan Glancy is absolutely right, if the National Health Service becomes overwhelmed, that helps nobody. So when I am under pressure to relax the restrictions that we have in place, and I have been under pressure this afternoon to relax some of the restrictions that we have in place, I simply say to members of Parliament, there is a fine balance to be struck, because the points that Pam Duncan Glancy puts to me are completely legitimate worries about the prospects of the National Health Service. So we have to take certain precautions and apply certain restrictions to make sure we avoid the scenario that she paints to Parliament today.
Stuart McMillan to be followed by Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, President Officer. With COVID still severely affecting our NHS, can the Deputy First Minister outline what additional funding is going to NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde to help ease pressures over the winter months, as my constituents and myself are keen to see the full reinstatement of the GP out of hours service in my constituency, which will afford local people the local service instead of having to travel to Paisley or Glasgow?
Deputy First Minister.
President Officer, Greater Glasgow and Clyde, National Health Service Greater Glasgow and Clyde has already received an additional funding of over £130 million so far this year to support COVID-related costs, and it will continue to receive all the necessary support throughout this pandemic. There will also be further support for NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde coming from the £300 million fund for winter funding pressures that were announced by the Health and Social Care Secretary some weeks ago, and that will obviously be the subject of discussion with the Health Board in question and for deployment in due course.
Jim Fairley to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Now, given the genuine concern which has been shown by Mr Ross and Mr Johnson in their questions today, I'm sure they will be welcoming of my question. Major employers in my constituency of Perthshire, Southend and Rosshire, Simon Howie Butchers, Glen Eagles Hotel and Creef Hydro have all been in contact to express their concern at the major shortages of staff that they are all suffering from. Now, I've written to the Home Secretary to demand that she take immediate and urgent action to alleviate this problem. However, what more can the Scottish Government do to help these businesses under the current devolved settlement, and should this Parliament not be asserting the powers to be able to manage our own immigration policy?
Deputy First Minister.
President Officer, many of the issues that Mr Fairley raises are connected to the points that we discussed, that I discussed with Rachel Hamilton a moment ago, that we are facing acute challenges in the availability of skills in a number of different sectors. It's not just health and social care, it's in hospitality, it's in transportation, it's in distribution, it's in some aspects of the rural economy, with which Mr Fairley is very familiar, and the hospitality sector. So the Scottish Government is taking measures to ensure that we support individuals who have perhaps lost employment in one sector to gain access to employment in other sectors, and that's through the retraining offer that we have in place. We have measures such as the Young Persons Guarantee, which are designed to make sure that young people have access to employment, to training, or to a college place when they require so. And we also have measures such as the National Transition Training Fund, which are designed to support individuals to make that transition from one sector to another. Lastly, we are also working with partners to try to ensure that those who are economically inactive are given every support possible to enable them to access the labour market, where they may be able to make a contribution to the skills requirements that we have within the economy at this time.
Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Emma Roddick.
Presiding Officer, me and my family last Tuesday went to see Beauty and the Beast with thousands of other people at the playhouse. Unfortunately, in a few weeks' time, parents or for maybe 100 won't be able to go and watch their children perform in a Christmas show. So will the government urgently bring forward guidance to allow nurseries and primary schools to have in-person concerts, or what is the difference between that and going to thousands of people going to a playhouse?
Deputy First Minister.
I think this relates back to the point I've just discussed with Pam Duncan Glancy about the the measures that we often have to take, which we'd rather not take, but have to take to try to protect the wider bulk of the population. Now, the point that Mr. Balfour raises with me involves a vast number of individuals entering into school premises when we have worked very hard, and schools have worked very hard, to keep the environment as focused as possible on the delivery of learning. And that's, I think, the right thing for schools to do, to make sure that young people are able to have uninterrupted access to their learning. Obviously, the issues that Balfour raises are issues that are the subject of local dialogue and discussion. I'm sure they will continue to be, and the government will make sure that these issues are properly aired in the Education Recovery Group to address the concerns that have been raised today.
Emma Roddick, to be followed by Jamie Halcrow-Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What is the Deputy First Minister doing to encourage transport providers to reinforce measures aimed at reducing the spread of COVID-19, particularly where services originate in other countries which may have different guidance?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, there's a lot of effort that's been put in by officials and also reinforced by ministers to discuss with individual transport providers the importance of the regulations in Scotland being properly applied within all transport settings. That has been the subject of a great deal of dialogue with transport providers. It's involved direct discussion with ministers. Having been on some of the public transport in Scotland in recent weeks, I've heard announcements been made. I happen to walked through Queen Street Station in Glasgow on Sunday, and there was very high adherence to wearing face coverings in Queen Street Station on Sunday. So I think Emma Roddick's point is absolutely valid. It's essential that such an approach is taken, and I assure her that ministers and officials are doing all that they can to make sure that message is heard by transport providers.
Jamie Halcrow-Johnson, to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. I was speaking in the last few days with a nurse whose workload is now focused away from their normal duties and solely on providing flu vaccinations and COVID boosters. While this is obviously extremely important work, as we've heard today, it takes members of staff away from other vital areas of our NHS and risks putting additional pressure on our already under pressure nursing staff. So can I ask the Deputy First Minister how many existing NHS staff have been diverted to providing vaccinations and booster jabs as their primary role? And given that Scotland already has a shortage of 3,400 nurses, can he also advise what efforts have been made to recruit vaccinators from other sources outside of existing NHS staff?
Deputy First Minister.
At the start of question time today, Mr. Ross gave a very warm welcome to the steps that have been taken to deliver the vaccination programme, and I thought his comments were absolutely appropriate and valid. And Mr. Halcrow-Johnson invites me now to... Well, Mr. Halcrow-Johnson essentially is complaining about the fact... Well, he is complaining about that, because to enable us to deliver the great performance that Mr. Ross has complimented, we have to use some National Health Service staff to enable that to be the case. Now, there's, I don't know what discussion is going on between Ms. Graham and Mr. Ross, but it's something to do with, the thing. Right, okay, so I'm trying to be helpful here. And Mr. Ross has welcomed the vaccine programme rollout. How do we manage that? We manage that by making sure it's the priority to give the maximum protection to the population. We give the maximum protection to the population, and Mr. Halcrow-Johnson comes along and moans about it. That just says it all about the Conservatives. Employment in the National Health Service is at a record level. We have never had more nurses working in the National Health Service than we have today.
Deputy First Minister, I wish to ensure that each and every member in this chamber can hear what is being said. That is absolutely impossible given current ongoing interruptions. So I would appreciate it if members could please ensure that everyone can hear what's being said. Thank you.
So, Presiding Officer, NHS staffing in Scotland is at a record high level and has increased by over 25,000 under this government. Yeah. So we've got more staff working in the National Health Service. According to Mr Ross, we've got a successful and effective vaccination programme. I would hope that that might give Mr Halcroft-Johnson some reassurance that the Scottish Government is doing everything it can to roll out the vaccination programme as quickly and as significantly as we possibly can do, and of course, the evidence demonstrates that that is the case.
I call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Deputy First Minister confirmed that Scotland now recognises vaccine certificates from 130 countries. But I'm still being contacted by constituents who've had one vaccine in Scotland but received another in either England or Wales and who remain unable to get valid certificates. Can the Deputy First Minister therefore update Parliament on when these ongoing issues will be resolved? And in the meantime, will he undertake to ensure any such cases raised with the government will be dealt with so that individuals aren't being left going from pillar to post?
Deputy First Minister.
I am aware that many of these cases are being resolved. In a programme that involves the vaccine, around about 10 million vaccinations, there are undoubtedly, I think we'd all accept, going to be challenges of absolute accuracy in all circumstances. So I can assure Mr MacArthur that these issues are being resolved. Where there is a need to take further steps, if members wish to contact ministers, we will do all that we can to resolve them as quickly as possible to ensure that individuals are not in any way disadvantaged by a lack of access to the COVID certificate.
And Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last week, the United Kingdom became the first country in the world to license an antiviral in the form of a pill, which clinical trials have found cuts the risk of hospitalisation or death by 50%. That's a game changer for the most vulnerable people. So have Scottish ministers acted to secure a supply of the new treatment? When will vulnerable Scottish patients get the benefit of it? And how will the use of this new treatment be prioritised?
Deputy First Minister.
President Officer, obviously these issues are issues that are part of the discussions on a four nations basis, as have all aspects of the vaccination programme that we've undertaken. And they will also obviously be the subject of clinical advice and clinical interventions. So the Health Secretary will be happy to update Parliament on the steps that are taken in relation to this matter as a consequence of the discussions that are taking place on a four nations basis.
That concludes the ministerial statement. COVID-19 update. There will be a very brief suspension.